Good morning. So before the service, Roy wanted to make sure I pronounced the composer right, and he reminded me it's Pachelbel, Bell, not Taco Bell. This is the kind of witty banter that we enjoy on MSPC staff. Jocularity, Roy, jocularity. So, okay, that one bombed. Good to see y'all as we get ready to worship this morning. I will invite you to pull out your In the Life of the Church insert, just so I can point you to a few things while you're doing that. Good morning to all of you joining us on Facebook, and we hope you're having a magnificent morning, and it's beautiful here. I hope it is beautiful where you are. Okay, a few things to point out to you. We are in the midst of this series called Fascination with God. We are culminating this series on the 29th, and that is going to be our fifth Sunday worship service. So one worship service at 10 o'clock on September 29th. Go ahead and make a mental note, jot that in your calendars. We'll be here at 10. I hope you will as well. And as you recall, we've been doing slightly different musical themes for all of these fifth Sundays. We're going to be going for a Celtic musical theme for that fifth Sunday. And I think it'll be a really cool way to finish up this series with the theme, "The Cosmos Culminates in Fascination with God." Again, September 29th. 10 o'clock worship service. A couple of other things to point out. Today is the last full day where we are receiving the clothing for the end of summer clothing drive. So if you have things to bring in, you can bring them back later this afternoon if you didn't bring them today. And this will be your last chance to go through your closets and all of the stuff. Our mission partners at Master Provisions will make sure that they get distributed around the world. Some winter clothing will stay here in the greater Cincinnati area. A lot of the summer clothing gets distributed all over the world to various mission partners. And So today is the last full day, and just bring them. If the trailer is locked up for some reason, you can just leave it by the office entry over there to my left, and I'll make sure they get in the trailer tomorrow morning. Okay, and then for our youth ministry is doing the Lasagna Make and Take event. Once again, that is going to be on September 29th, the fifth Sunday, so just a couple of weeks from now. And this has proven to be a very popular event over the years. This year, they are making lasagnas that will go to our City Gospel Mission efforts. And so our City Gospel Mission team will take some of these lasagnas and use them the next time we are serving supper at City Gospel Mission. And so if you have youth in your family, children, grandchildren, neighbors that you're wanting to invite, this is a great opportunity. If you would like to learn more about that, touch base with Missy Hardy. She would be delighted to tell you more about that. Okay, all the rest you can take a look at your leisure, but now, my friends, we are ready to worship. And so I'm going to invite you to take this 60 seconds of time that we customarily are setting apart at the start of worship, just so we can focus our hearts and minds. We all come with lots of things going on in our brains, and this is the time to set that down, to open your hearts to hear from the living Lord and to hear his voice and to hear his leading. It's my belief that God has something for every single one of us in worship today. So let us open ourselves up to listen to the move of the Holy Spirit. Let us prepare our hearts to worship.
Please join with me in prayer. Eternal God, as we gather, we come to worship and acknowledge that you have created us and the world and all that's in it. We come and know that you are with us, even in dwelling in our hearts, but we come to this special place to worship together, to praise your holy name, and to acknowledge who you are. As we gather, speak to our hearts, open our hearts and minds to hear your message for us today through song, sermon, scripture. Speak to us that we might know where you want us to be and what we are to do to be your disciples and light to the world. We come together acknowledging your presence, praying together the prayer our Lord taught his disciples to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come, we gather acknowledging that God is ready, willing, and able to forgive when we confess our sins and ask to be forgiven. He has cleared the way. So let us join in our unison prayer of confession. Eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, your face is hidden from us by our sins, and in the blindness of our hearts, we have forgotten your mercy. Cleanse us from all our proud thoughts and vain desires, so that we may draw near to you with reverent and humble hearts, confessing our faults, confiding in your grace, and finding in you our refuge and strength. Through Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Be reconciled to God and one another. In Jesus' name, amen. And now I believe we are ready to receive God's tithes and offerings as we come acknowledging again that all things come from the Lord. So prepare your hearts and consider what you would return to God of your time, talents, and treasures. Precious Lord, giver of life, creator of the world, we gather and give you thanks for all that you have provided for us. Use these tithes and offerings to further your kingdom, that we might be a light to our world, and that not only our finances, but also our time and our talents might be used to further your work and further your kingdom. Bless each one who gives back to you. In Jesus' name, we dedicate these gifts. Amen. We come together as forgiven sons and daughters of our Lord and Savior, just as your neighbor sitting next to you or behind you in front of you. So let us share his peace that God has given us with those around us. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Sanctuary, all of us who are gathered here at in the sanctuary of Madura Silverwood wish to all of you who are joining us online the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be and abide with all of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning begins in the book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 through 33. Listen to the word of God. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb, when I made the clouds the garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, 'This far you may come and no farther. Here is where your proud waves halt.' Have you ever given orders to the morning, or shown the dawn its place, that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. So have you journeyed to the springs of the sea, or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the deepest darkness? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. What is the way to the abode of light? And where does darkness reside? Can you take them to their places? Do you know the paths to their dwellings? Surely you know, for you were already born. You have lived so many years. Have you entered the storehouses of the snow, or seen the storehouses of the hail, which I reserve for times of trouble, for days of war and battle? What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed, or the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? Who cuts a channel for the torrents of rain and a path for the thunderstorm, to water a land where no one lives, an uninhabited desert, to satisfy a desolate wasteland and make it sprout with grass? Does a rain have a father? Who fathers the drops of dew? From whose womb comes the ice? Who gives birth to the frost from the heavens when the waters become hard as stone, when the surface of the deep is frozen? Can you bind the chains of the Pleiades? Can you loosen Orion's belt? Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons, or lead out the bear with its cubs? Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth?" Then the Lord said to Job, "Will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Can let him who accuses God answer him?" Then Job answered the Lord, "I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but I have no answer. Twice, but I will say no more. This is the word of the Lord.
And may God bless the reading and the teaching of his word. Amen. All right, so we continue our series, Fascination with God. We're talking about this idea, this notion that God is not just some distant abstract concept or uninvolved in the universe, but rather God is real and personal and wants to have this relationship with us. And in this relationship, we develop the relationship by being fascinated by the person and the character and the being of who God is. And as we've been talking about this last week, or we began the series with talking about creation and how God in creation draws us into a deeper fascination with him. Then on the first Sunday of the month, we talked about the Lord's Supper and how the sacrament of the communion, it leads us into this grasp of the work of Christ and how that draws us into a deeper fascination with the living God. Last week, we talked about sufferings. We talked about how even in our sufferings, God speaks to us and draws us into this deeper fascination. Today, we're talking about the mysteries of the cosmos, the mysteries of the universe, the vastness and the incomprehensibility of, you know, when we face the cosmos and our mind is just blown because we are so small. So in a way, these it just builds on the themes we've had before. And I chose for this passage from the book of Job, a little bit of context about the book of Job. Many ancient scholars believe that the Job is the oldest of the complete books of the Hebrew Bible. Yeah, that's very ancient. It's telling the story of Job, who was a wise man, a righteous man, who was recognized in many cultures across the ancient Near East, not just in the Hebrew scriptures, but in many other cultures. Job is recognized as a renowned man of righteousness and wisdom. And it's telling the story of his sufferings. It begins with two chapters that take place in the heavenly courts, and it shows God and Satan arguing over the righteousness of Job, and Satan basically challenging God and saying, if you took all his blessings away, he would curse you. And God's like, oh, really? Well, let's try this and see. And so there's this back and forth, and God allows Satan to afflict Job. And Job loses his family, loses all his wealth, loses everything that he has, and he's grieving and he's mourning. Three friends come to grieve alongside with him for several days. Those guys never get credit for shutting up and staying with him quietly for several days. But then they begin to discuss and argue, and it becomes 35 chapters, 35 long chapters, a philosophical discussion and argument about why do the righteous suffer? What are the mysteries of the universe? What, you know, when you, about being struck by the incomprehensible nature of the universe. It is 35 chapters of philosophy that I would put on par with any other product of the ancient world. I'd put it right up there with Plato's dialogues, right up there with the works of Seneca, right up there with any of the ancient works. It is a masterpiece of poetry and philosophy wrestling with the mysteries of the universe. And then, after 35 chapters of wrestling, we get this, where God, the Lord, spoke to Job out of the storm. So God shows up and speaks. Now, before we dive into this, let's talk about the mysteries of the universe. Most of us probably are really taken up with the busyness of the day. You know, we're doing our stuff. We're getting our laundry done. We're going to work. We're getting things taken care of. We're just taken with the busyness and business of the day that's before us. But hopefully, all of us get time where we can take a step back, where we can ponder, where we are actually struck by the vastness of the cosmos and creation. Some of us travel to do that. Yeah, I have a very vivid memory of our experience. My family took a trip when I was in, fifth or sixth grade, took a trip out west. The culmination of this trip, or the centerpiece, I should say, was actually the very beginning of the trip. The centerpiece of this trip was a rafting trip down the Grand Canyon, and just being surrounded, immersed in this vast geological work on Earth's planet. And then you know, it's 5 days, so we're camping out in crevasses in the Grand Canyon and looking up at night with some of the clearest skies. Still vivid memory of how clear the skies were and how clearly I could see the Milky Way splayed out above me, and being struck again by the vastness of the universe. And then on the last day, rafting Lava Falls, which is this huge rapids, incredibly dangerous rapids, at the very end of the canyon, and you're being struck by the power and the force, and realizing how small I was. That made quite a lasting impression. We all have, hopefully, we all have times and moments in our lives where we are confronted with the bigness, with the power of the cosmos. We realize how small we really are, how puny we really are. Now, there are different responses that we can have to this. There would be some who would take a materialistic worldview. Please note, I'm distinguishing between a scientific and a materialistic worldview. Science, again, science is figuring out the hows. You know, how does this universe work? How do the material things of this universe work? How does biology work? How does the how of everything? But materialism would say there is no why, that there is just the material world, the world of matter and energy. There's nothing more. And there's no intelligence behind it all. It just is. A materialistic worldview would look at all of the cosmos and say it is cold, it is dark, it is terribly frightening, and there is no meaning to it at all. It just is. And we are a speck, an accident and a speck adrift in all of this cosmos. And that would be one way of approaching it. Another way of approaching it would be to take a spiritual perspective, with the idea that there is mind, there is purpose behind everything. But even in a spiritual perspective, that doesn't necessarily mean that it is a benign mind. And many pagan religions would see the spiritual forces in the world being quite hostile, and needing to be placated by systems of magic. Interestingly, this kind of spiritual worldview, where it's a hostile or antagonistic spiritual forces out there, that plays into a lot of science fiction, fantasy, and particularly fantasy and horror literature. And I find this kind of literature to be kind of instructive in some ways. One of the granddaddies of contemporary fantasy and horror is a writer named H.P. Lovecraft. He was writing in the early 20th century. He's quite well known in folks who read that kind of genre. And the root, he built this mythos, this worldview of these fictional, fantastical, supremely powerful beings. And these supremely powerful beings, they have no interest in humanity. Humanity is like bugs before them. They're completely indifferent to us. And we are just caught up in their wars. And we are like ants while elephants fight. And the horror that he is conveying is that we are caught up in these forces that we have absolutely no control over, and they don't care about us. Now, that's another perspective. But the Hebrew Bible gives us yet another perspective. that there is mind, there is intelligence, there is design behind the cosmos, there is will, there is purpose behind everything, and the mind of God is not hostile to us, but interested in us. And so we begin. The Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. Now, it sounds pretty rough. Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. And so we see in this, though, while it sounds harsh, think about this for a moment. This is not indifference. This is not God is so vast and you are a bug not worth my attention. The mental picture here is that God will engage. God speaks. For those who earnestly seek, for those, remember, 35 chapters of kvetching, of wrestling, of seeking, of asking. And God speaks. And God speaks, and he will respond. And that is an intrinsic part of the mindset of the ancient Hebrew worldview. That God speaks, God draws near to his people, even after what seems like a long silence, even after what seems like a baffling incomprehensibility. God does speak. God speaks, but God doesn't speak as some kind of tamed genie in a bottle. We are struck with the grandness, the majesty. Brace yourself like a man, I will question you. We're struck by the bigness of God. See, theologian Rudolf Otto, another early 20th century writer, theologian Rudolf Otto, you would have no reason to have ever heard the name Rudolf Otto, but he was huge back in the early 1900s. And he, among his many books, the only one I've actually read is The Idea of the Holy. And in The Idea of the Holy, he is dealing with the religious emotions. And he's trying to nail down what is this emotional experience that we have when we are confronted with the mysteries of the universe and have this encounter with a benign yet all-powerful God. And that's a whole book trying to explain a feeling, a religious experience. And you know, he uses all kinds of analogies. He talks about awe. He talks about the experience of the sublime. He talks about all of these things, but it's ultimately not getting at what that experience is. Because the experience with God is a singularity. I mean, it's a singular thing that ultimately words fail us. Because we are encountering that which is beyond, that which is transcendent, that which is mind-blowing. And he talks about it as not just awe and reverence, but also attractive, drawing in, fascination. This, you know, his thought is this: the genesis of this whole series I've been talking about fascination with God. When we are confronted with this bigness, this majesty, we can't help but pay attention. So when God shows up to Job and says, brace yourself like a man, I will question you, he is not hiding from God. He's paying attention. And then what comes next is this tsunami of questions. It's funny because John caught me before the service, like, you sure you want me to read this whole thing? And I was like, well, yes, I do. Because part of the poetry of the book of Job is the tsunami of questions. It's just one after another. There's no change. For 35 chapters, Job and his friends have been dialoguing back and forth. I will say this. And then, but here, there's not a lot of back and forth. There is some back and forth, but it's a tsunami of questions. Who is this? Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Who's marked off its dimensions? And have you ever given orders to the morning? Have the gates of death been shown to you? What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed, to the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? It just goes on and on and on and on. Who are you? Well, have you seen this? Can you really grasp the foundations of the universe? You little human, all your knowledge, can you really grasp the bigness of the cosmos? And this is poetry. It's not a scientific treatise. You know, it's easy to look at that and dismiss this as, well, that's a Bronze Age ancient worldview talking about storehouses. We know that the hail's not really in a storehouse. I suggest to you, most of the ancients knew that hail wasn't really stored up in a storehouse. It's poetry. It's metaphor, because that's almost the only way we can speak about mystery, is in poetry and metaphor. If we were to use our contemporary understanding, if I were to do a contemporary translation, were you there at that first explosion when everything came spinning into existence? Were you there as the laws of physics began to coalesce and to form? Were you there when the galaxies began to rotate and to spin and around? Were you there when the laws of gravity began to draw things together? Were you there as the suns cooled, as things began to form? I mean, we can push this. We weren't there. We can describe our best theories and thoughts. We were not there to see the whys, purpose, the meaning, and the thought. Now, a theory, you can say it's meaningless. You can say that, and that's a theory that many take. But I suggest that's not the only reasonable way to approach the cosmos. There is mind, intention, purpose, and I would even say joy. I love this. You know, this is why I love the wisdom literature of the ancient Hebrews, because it's not just you puny human beings. Take a look. It's the last paragraph on that first page. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what worth footing set, or who laid the cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy. Isn't that marvelous? The poetry is bringing out this metaphor of the stars in song, of the spiritual heavenly beings rejoicing. In other words, the worldview that's in play here is that it's not just everything has been structured, the forces of nature, but there's joy and delight that is woven into the fabric of creation. Isn't that grand? Isn't that wonderful? And you see, this is where materialist writers and thinkers, they can't get away from this sense of joy and delight and intelligence that undergirds creation. Some of the most materialist thinkers out there. Let's take, for instance, Richard Dawkins. I'm not going to argue with Richard Dawkins about science. I'm not a scientist. But I do know a few things about words. I know a few things about language. And The Selfish Gene, this is the kind of language Dawkins uses. It is almost as if the universe were trying to produce a machine that can think and feel and explore its own origins. This is the extraordinary cleverness of natural selection. Now, I'm not going to debate with you about natural selection, but it's so interesting that he talks about an impersonal, meaningless force as being clever. The use of language of cleverness implies that there is a mind being clever. It implies intention. It implies that there's somebody showing off. You know, elsewhere, Stephen Jay Gould in Structure of Evolutionary Theory, the world of living things is a marvel of evolutionary ingenuity. If you have ingenuity, you've got a mind being ingenious. You've got intention and some kind of delight and cleverness and joy in the intention. with adaptations, they're exquisitely tailored. Accident doesn't tailor things. Accidents are accidents. Tailoring implies craftsmanship. This is how language works. Language has meaning and implication. And we can come up with much more precise ways to communicate meaninglessness in the universe. And all the point I'm getting at is that for us to try to communicate with one another, the very interest and excitement, we have to use this language of intention. Even the materialists do. Now, if that is the case, I suggest to you, perhaps that is because there is mindfulness and intention and purpose woven deep within the universe and woven deep within us to recognize it. Then all the stuff just becomes a debate about process, about how the mind created. That's a completely different debate. But is there mind? We can't even talk about this stuff intelligently without using language that presupposes that there is purpose, intent, creativity, and joy in creation. I find that pretty astonishing. And so, is that irrefutable proof? No, it's not irrefutable proof. But it makes it very reasonable to me. Reasonable that there is the mind of God undergirding everything, and that when I face the mysteries of the cosmos that I cannot grasp, that I'm not looking at a cold, dark, empty space, but that I'm looking at a warm universe that crackles, that brims with fascination, joy, and delight. Now, the dialogue goes on. It goes on for, the monologue, the tsunami of questions goes on for quite some time. And then it's interesting, right there, the last paragraph, the Lord said to Job, "Will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him." And then Job answered the Lord. Now, again, I mean, it's not much of a dialogue, and yet it is still dialogue. God is inviting conversation. Job is not struck mad by this encounter with the incomprehensible power. So God is accommodating himself to Job. And Job answers, "I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but have no answer. Twice, but will say no more." The irony here is there's actually another couple of chapters where God does speak again and Job replies again, you know. But, you know, I didn't want to overwhelm you too much. But the picture that we get here, there's not easy answers that Job has been given. He gets an encounter. He gets an encounter with a living God who holds all things in his hands and yet accommodates to be able to communicate, to relate. And I suggest to you, if you earnestly seek, again, 35 chapters of kvetching, of wrestling, communicating to me that sometimes it is a long struggle through a lot of silence. And yet, I believe God speaks to those who earnestly seek. God speaks. And it may be not in the voice of a storm. It may be in that still, small voice. It may be in that time where you are standing before the ocean and watching the storms move in, and you go, "Ah, God is there riding the storm." It may be in the still watches of the night when you are wrestling and turning, and you can't shut off the brain, and you cry out, and there in the darkness you feel that hand and that presence come down upon you, saying, "All will be well, and all will be well, and all manner of things will be well." I don't know, because I suspect it's probably distinctive for each one of us. But this I believe, The universe is not a cold place where we fret and struggle for our fourscore and however many years, and then we pass into an empty blackness of non-sentience. Now, it's my belief that the universe is a warm place that brims with mind and intelligence and communication with the living God speaking to us and calling us home. My hope is that each of us, when faced with the mysteries of the universe, can hear the call of that living God. So I'm going to invite you now to take a little bit of time, as is our custom. Let's just take a few moments to sit, to be still, to listen. Listen for his voice. What is the Almighty saying to you now? He's been talking to you all during this worship services in subtle and perhaps strong ways. What have you been hearing? And what's one thing you may do, small though it may be, to respond to him? Let's abide with the Lord. Sisters, go in grace, go in mercy, go in peace. May the living Lord Jesus Christ go with you. May he go above you to watch over you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, within you to give you peace, and before you to show you the way, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.